Welcome, folks. I'm Jabby Kawai, joined by Chuck Kirk.
Yo!
We're looking at Venom, Let There Be Carnage, break down Easter eggs and details you missed from New Rockstars. Thank you, New Rockstars, for allowing us to react to this. Very, very much appreciate it, y'all. If you haven't already, subscribe to New Rockstars. There's a link in the description below for the original video that we're about to watch. Click on that, give the original an upvote, subscribe to them. Also, please subscribe here, hit that bell icon, all notifications, and vote this video up to let YouTube know you're enjoying what you're watching. All right, here we go.
Welcome back to New Rockstars. I'm Eric Voss, and this is a breakdown of Venom, Let There Be Carnage, a film that further ensnares Eddie Brock in stickier love affairs that use way too much tongue. I'm not just talking about Carnage. Oh, spoiler warning for the film's post-credit scene. Venom's now getting Peter Parker in on that action, and I am uncomfortable with it. I'm going to break down all of the Easter eggs and interesting filmmaking details that you might have missed in this film. And by the way, the best way that you can support what we do here at New Rockstars is by checking out our great merch options.
Yeah.
Like our latest Venom Let There Be Carnage inspired design, Symbiotic Chaos, at NewRockstarsMerch.com. Okay, we open on the St. Estes Reform School in 1996, based on the St. Estes Home for Boys in the Marvel Comics, the orphanage where Cletus Kasady lived as a kid and allegedly burned down before becoming the Venom symbiote offshoot Carnage and first meeting Spider-Man in the ruins of this building. Now, in 1996, Woody Harrelson was the 35-year-old star of Kingpin and the People vs. Larry Flint, so here playing young Cletus is actor Jack Bandera, but they still had Woody Harrelson voice the character to open the film with Harrelson's iconic soft indoor voice before we reveal the character as an unhinged psychopath, all to ground Cletus's priorities as his romantic love for Francis Barrison, aka Shriek, the Marvel villain who teams up with Carnage in the Maximum Carnage storyline in the comics. Her character is capable of releasing these powerful sonic blasts, which Francis describes as saying, "My mutations are advancing." Previously, the word mutant was somewhat avoided, at least in the MCU films, but now that Marvel Studios owns the X-Men IP, and this movie with its post-credit scene is linked with the MCU, is just another sign of how this is all connected to a multiverse of Marvel characters where mutants can now exist.
Yay!
Have you ever heard of a male character that has supersonic vocal abilities, like scream abilities of any kind? Because anytime I've seen that superpower, it's only been on a woman.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that just makes sense, though.
Well, you think so what?
I think I agree with you that I've only ever seen females with sonic abilities.
Yeah.
I mean, people who read comics or whatever will probably be correcting us hardcore in the comments, but it seems to make sense to me just because, you know, women are good at screaming and we can reach a higher pitch usually than many men.
Right.
Unless it's like the Sonic Boom Bass edition.
My earliest memory of that is Kitana's mother in Mortal Kombat 3. I forgot her name. She had a screaming ability and it was kind of amazing.
Away, escorted by the young cop P. Mulligan, later Detective Mulligan, whom she deafens in one ear as he shoots her in the eye to create her eye scar from the comics. And she's taken to the Ravencroft Institute, the superhero prison and laboratory from the Marvel Comics, an East Coast version of which showed up in The Amazing Spider-Man 2 in 2014. She's overseen by Dr. Pazzo, the name of a Ravencroft doctor whom Carnage takes captive in the Venom Carnage Unleashed series. Tom Hardy returns as Eddie Brock and the voice of Venom, last seen in the 2018 film, transitioning from a star TV investigator to print journalist, interviewing serial killer Cletus Kasady in San Quentin. And now we know his employer is the Daily Bugle West Coast edition, since it is headquartered in New York, and it has the same masthead as the version of the Daily Bugle from the Sam Raimi Spider-Man trilogy, despite those movies having their own Eddie Brock played by Topher Grace. But with the multiversal implications of this movie's post-credit scene, those paradoxes either don't really matter or are about to matter a whole lot. Eddie and Venom feud with Detective Mulligan, whom Venom nearly bites the head off of. Actually, later, Mulligan's tussle with Carnage and Shriek leaves his eyes glowing, setting him up as a future symbiote toxin, as Mulligan becomes the comics. Venom begs Eddie to play vigilante.
He did mention that before.
They're protecting the city lethally.
Setting up their reunion by the end of this movie as the lethal protector.
Nodding,
of course, to the Venom Lethal Protector storyline that both this movie and its predecessor are inspired by, in which Eddie Brock works in San Francisco and teams up with Spider-Man. As this movie's closed moments hint, will happen at some point in the films. Eddie interviews Cletus again, who tells him to print this cryptic quote, "The distant cathedral is all I see, that fractured angel the other part of me." Yeah, this movie shows Eddie's investigative journalism into the mind of Cletus Kasady as a kind of Goonie-style treasure hunt, with rhyming clues and using the shape shape of a coastline as X marks the spot. And all this comes from Venom's photographic memory of the carvings in Cletus' prison cell, which Venom redraws for Eddie, a way of showing how Venom's symbiote mind is far more advanced than Eddie's human memory is. He really needs him to be able to function. And the walls of Cletus' prison cell are covered with fun stuff, like there's a teddy bear, his stick figure self torturing an animal in a cage, it looks like, a figure holding a severed head, the words, "The Phoenix will rise," Cassidy's figure self with his hands up as a gun fires a bullet that loops over his head, probably his own joke that the cops never fully closed the case on all of his murders. And then this quote, "Thus strangely are our souls constructed, and by slight ligaments are we bound to prosperity and ruin." This is a quote from Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, in which Dr. Victor Frankenstein considers morality a tight wire act as he stitches together the body parts of dead criminals into a reanimated corpse that goes on to consider itself above the morality of mankind, reflecting Cletus's arc in this movie as a condemned criminal about to be a corpse, becoming a sort of resurrected supernatural monster with a hell of an ego. And then on the other wall of the cell, there's Cletus himself in a cage above a tombstone that says "Hell for Vanished Children," similar to the sign outside St. Estes that's marked "Home for Unwanted Children." And then there's a carving of the tree that Eddie later looks at on the sketch form and then later finds on these grounds with a different quote, "To thee the strife was given between the suffering." This is a line from a poem called Prometheus from 1816 by English poet Lord Byron, which praises Prometheus, the titan from Greek mythology, who stole fire from the gods and gave it to the mortals, which is also a reflection of Cletus' journey as a deceitful mortal who steals the power that came, really, if you think about it, from the heavens. So the sketches take them to Rodeo Beach in Marin County. It's 2 miles north of the Golden Gate Bridge. It's known for unique rock formations on the coastline. And here they find more of Cletus' victims, causing the governor to lift California's moratorium on the death penalty, moratorium that our governor, Gavin Newsom, ordered in 2019. And this movie hints the governor did this to boost his poll numbers. Maybe a nod to the recent recall effort that Newsom was able to survive, that I had to spend all summer talking about to older relatives in other parts of the country who were like excited it might happen because they all weirdly hate California, but jokes on them, it rules here, and we love our rich history of infamous serial killers, and it turns out executing.
Was Prometheus a villain in the stories or a good guy?
He was a good guy. It depends who you're talking to, right? If from the point of view of the gods, they punished him because he stole fire, which belonged to the gods. Okay. He stole fire and he gave it to humans.
Okay.
And fire, you know, was instrumental to human development.
Okay.
So to humans, Prometheus is a hero figure.
Okay.
But he got severely punished.
By the gods.
Yes. If I remember correctly, he got tied down and his guts are being perpetually eaten by like vultures.
So he's in hell, basically?
Basically for the rest of time.
Okay.
If I remember correctly, guys, correct me if I'm wrong. Why, did you think Prometheus was a villain?
I was just asking because he mentioned it. It was alluded to here with all the quotes and stuff like that. And I just wanted to know like how much it was an inspiration, how much it was tied to, because, you know, this power came from the gods, so to speak. It came from the sky and it was given to Eddie. And then what's his name? Cletus stole it from him.
So usually in classic literature, Prometheus is a symbol for gaining knowledge.
Okay.
Or power,
okay.
You know, and yeah, it is coming from the gods. And so he makes that connection here where the symbiotes are from space, right?
Right.
And so that's up there,
right?
So to speak. So yeah, it is coming from the gods.
The heavens.
The heavens.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the idea. It's, right. It's interesting to kind of make that crossover between classic literature themes and put it into pop culture. That's really cool.
And I guess the last element is it didn't die off because now it's inside the cop.
Right. Yeah. There's more. That venom is just like...
It's resilient.
Yeah. Reproducing like crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As Mulligan reacts to this news in the Daily Bugle, in his office, there's a booking photo for E. Larson, a nod to Eric Larson, comic book artist and writer from the 90s Spider-Man era, moving on to co-found Image Comics. Eddie's apartment is a mess. It's covered in M&Ms for Venom's love of chocolate, because this movie says chocolate contains phenylethylamine that they say is also in human brains, suggesting, I guess, that chocolate is Venom's anti-drug replacement for eating human brains. But in actuality, phenylethylamine, when consumed, causes the brain to release other chemicals chemicals. So it's not in the brain itself, but I just think Eddie might have told Venom this in order to get him to stop eating people. Eddie also tried to use chickens, but Venom named two of them Sonny and Cher after the singing duo. And then he's also got a tire chew toy that he named Snooky. Now, when Venom overtakes Eddie, their new height punches a hole in the ceiling, and I like how you can actually see past the ceiling holes from when this has happened previously.
Yeah.
They return to the bodega of Mrs. Chen from the first movie, where Venom adjusts on the rack a publication bearing the likeness of Stan Lee. It even names him on the cover, calling back Stan's cameo as a dog walker in the previous film and confirming that Stan was just playing himself. Venom takes the reins and stops a mugging, leaving Eddie dangling while he gets a call from Anne, who tells him that she needed some space after the alien incident before, referring to when she turned into She-Venom in the 2018 film, and she meets Eddie in their old favorite restaurant, but now what was previously a blue background lighting is red, reflecting Carnage's growing influence in Eddie's life. Anne shows Eddie the new engagement ring she got from Dan, which Eddie comments is so much bigger than the one I got you, and when you actually compare the two side by side, Dan got the more expensive flourish of a double halo around the center stone, mm-hmm. so truly it's just a cosmetically nicer upgrade from
and
Eddie.
And an eternity band. It does look about the same size,
but
though.
But only Eric Voss and new rock stars would compare some like a detail like that, that specific detail.
Yeah.
I do appreciate the nod to the background lighting with the DP brought to it, representing Carnage being a stronger presence this time around as opposed to the blue background. I didn't even remember the restaurant scene from the first film. I only watched Venom once, so, you know, naturally I might forget a forgettable scene like that.
So Venom tries to cheer up Eddie with a messy breakfast while he plays Let's Call the Whole Thing Off from the 1937 Gershwin musical Shall We Dance. It's a song about a couple trying to work past their differences, and Venom includes with all the food a whole bunch of painkillers, which you'll notice Eddie just keeps lying around because obviously he needs them. Venom also drops in the mail, including Cletus's postcard with its tiny, tiny writing, and Venom asks Eddie if he's pen pals with an ant, something that Eddie might now be able to do with Ant-Man now that they're in the same universe and both living in San Francisco. But Cletus wrote this letter, and it looks like in his own blood, saying every hero has an origin story as he crushes a spider.
Did you notice that?
Yes.
The spider, I mean, it was quite obvious.
Yeah.
Like, come on.
Yeah.
We know what that's about.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, a meta joke about how this isn't a Spider-Man origin story. Actually, Venom and Carnage's origins in these movies have been completely spider-less, and only after Carnage's death does Spider-Man enter the picture.
Yes.
We learn all about his past as a child pushing his grandmother down a flight of stairs, as he does in the comics, but also electrocuting his mother with a hairdryer during a bath, and his father abusing him. And so Eddie visits Cletus during his final meal, where Cletus calls him a cancer, and Venom lashes out, allowing Cletus to bite Eddie on the hand, actually the same way Peter Parker got his powers, except here it's reversed, with the biter getting the powers. And the way Cletus sucked up that spider as he crushed it on his hand, here, as the blood wiggles on his finger, he slurps it all up. Actually, in the comics, Cletus and Eddie share a prison cell, and there, an offshoot of the Venom symbiote latches onto Cletus, turning him into Carnage. That's why in this film, the Carnage symbiote considers itself Venom's offspring, calling him father. Now, if you stream or podcast, or if you want to sound good when you're gaming, the HyperX Quadcast is dynamic of CP. Or use the link in this video's description to grab yourself a HyperX Quadcast mic and start sounding and looking better. Eddie and Venom fight.
Buddy, I'm the only person that took you in when your friends kicked you off the planet Ming-Mong because you are a reject.
Yeah, Eddie says planet Ming-Mong, which in reality, Venom's home planet is Clintar, which is also the name of his species. Venom actually hints that he's ready to share his hive mind with Eddie in the post-credit scene, but the multiverse collision interrupts it or might have caused it. I go into that in our post-credit scene breakdown. You should check it out. Now, director Andy Serkis broke this fight scene down for Vanity Fair, describing how they upgraded Venom's appearance from the 2018 film to add some lip texturing around Venom's wide jaw and eyebrow bulges, all in order to give Venom's face a more expressive quality. Now, Serkis obviously draws upon his own extensive background in the relationship between physical performance and VFX animation from when he brought to life Gollum and Snoke and Caesar from the Planet of the Apes trilogy, which are an amazing group of films there. You should check them out. And Serkis also revealed that Tom Hardy pre-recorded all of Venom's dialogue and then would play it back in his ear so that he could have the real argument with Venom's voice all going on in his head.
Wow.
If you look closely, you can actually see the earbud tucked way in his ear there. Also, when Venom breaks
Eddie's
nose,
I can't really see it.
Just so we can break it again, you can see where Venom resets that broken nose and the bruising fades away right before he punches him again. This is just like how Venom fixed Eddie's broken bones after the motorcycle crash in the previous film. Now, on the night of his execution, Cletus quotes Shakespeare's Macbeth.
Something wicked.
this way down!
I didn't catch that when he said it.
The second half of the couplet spoken by the second witch foretelling the arrival of the morally corrupt Macbeth. Actually, the full couplet is, by the pricking of my thumb, something wicked this way comes. And if you think about it, Cletus acquired his powers by biting the fingers of Eddie, leaving his own finger bloody and then sucking it back up. And it's from his fingers that the wicked Carnage comes. Carnage blocks the lethal injection and transforms Cletus's flesh. His design is sickening, with pockmarks on his tongue to make him look all decaying. Also, in general, a more slender build compared to Venom, an ooze dripping off his tendrils. He's got a raptor-like roar. And then a splash of black on his face, which I think is to link him to his parent symbiote Venom.
Gotcha.
He attacks the cell block, using tendrils to stab and hurl guards around. He wrenches one guard, and then he forms a big cyclone. And when they try to shoot him, Carnage opens a hole in his chest to let the bullet sail through, meaning that for now at least, he and Cletus do have a functioning symbiosis. Their flesh is infused, one in the same. Cletus dances out of San Quentin and sings, "And I'll walk out a wiser, stronger man, Mr. Warden, he tastes just like ham," which is a parody of Johnny Cash's song San Quentin, named after this prison, in which the normal lyric is, "And I'll walk out a wiser, weaker man, Mr. Congressman, you can't understand." You'll notice during this whole final act of the film, Eddie wears a Detroit Lions jacket over a Mumford Phys Ed shirt, which is a nod to another famous Eddie Murphy.
You called it.
I did, huh? I said that. When did I say that?
Well, maybe we saw. Maybe we saw this from another New Rockstars video.
No, he has not. I don't know if he's made that connection, but like I thought
for you it wasn't the jacket. For you, it was the way he said
it. It was the way he said it because I love that stand up. I watched that so many times when I was in college. The Eddie Murphy roar, and I love that joke about his ex-wife from Africa who's always like, Eddie, what have you done for me lately? And the way that Tom Hardy voiced Venom and sometimes how he would go, Eddie.
Yeah.
I was like, oh man, it sounds a lot like that to me.
Eddie Murphy in Beverly Hills Cop 2. Venom attends a rave with a cameo by rapper Little Sims, which becomes essentially Venom's coming out party. He even says in his speech that he has come out of the Eddie closet. Meanwhile, Cletus suits up in a new look and steals a car and then uses Carnage tendrils to hack the internet, which is a nod to Carnage infamously sneaking into a computer and using the internet to invade the homes of his prey in the comics. One of the really crazy things that he does. And then back at the Ravencroft Institute, there is another inmate there named Siegfried. I looked it up. There's not a prominent Siegfried in the Marvel comics other than a kind of obscure antagonist to Dum-Dum Dugan in the old Sergeant Fury comics. I don't think it's him. Just kind of a missed opportunity. Like he could have thrown a rhino in there, you know? But Carnage breaks into Shriek's confinement and uses his tendrils to hug her cell and crushes it to bring him into an embrace.
But wouldn't that like hurt her?
Red convertible. Woody Harrelson definitely giving off some natural born killer vibes here. Meanwhile, Venom collapses in Ms. Chen's store via drunk partier and oozes out of him, and later overtaking Ms. Chen's face to Anne and Dan in the funniest scene of the film. Shriek tries to find Eddie at his place and sees a photo of Anne and then goes after her and Dan, all so that they can have guests to their red wedding. And at one point, Anne once again becomes She-Venom to break Eddie out of custody, and then the wedding goes down in Grace Cathedral, similar to Carnage's church setting in the final level of the Maximum Carnage video game, and Venom sees Carnage for the first time.
Oh, shit! It's a red one!
Now, don't be too hung up on the color here. It's not like there's a Yoshi color-coding system to symbiote hierarchy. Venom is just recognizing that Carnage is more intertwined with Cletus's actual blood, which freaks him out because he's been having some insecurities about his own level of symbiosis with Eddie. Carnage bites off the head of a priest that they brought there to officiate the wedding, saying, "Power up!" Using him to grow? So I guess clergy is symbiote superfood? Carnage looms over Venom.
No, it's brains!
Glass, which the director called an homage to the Leonardo da Vinci Vitruvian Man sketch, which Da Vinci drew to suggest intelligent design and the ratios of human anatomical structure. The fact that Carnage is crudely recreating this is just another example of his let there be Carnage ego. He considers himself a god embarking upon his own genesis, the dawn of a new era. But the battle turns when Carnage tries to kill Shriek because he hates her sonic blasts and he's pissed off that she cares about Anne's life, and that turns Cletus against Carnage and proving to Venom that they do not have the true symbiosis.
The thing that he just broke down about Carnage believing that basically he's a god or that he's greater, or all these the egomaniacal behavior and whatnot, that didn't come through strong enough in the movie for me.
No, it's coming through now that he's explaining it.
Yeah, there's nuances of it here and there, but the movie was too short. It was 90 minutes long. It could have probably used another 10 to 12 minutes of allowing us to really get to know who Carnage is. Because, I mean, it says the movie's titled Let There Be Carnage. We only really know it through Woody Harrelson's character, who we got a lot of backstory of, but we didn't get anything of Carnage, who's discovering himself and believes so strongly, like, you know, his presence in the world. Like, he wants to kill Venom off because he's like, basically, it's like Highlander. There can only be one.
There can be only one.
He's got to assert his dominance, like the Animal Kingdom. But that's it. It's very primal and nothing further. But like the way they're breaking it down here, I'm like, oh, there's so much more that could have been explored in this film. Why did they feel the compulsion to make this 90 minutes and cut out all that? Like, there must be like a 2-hour version of this movie. Just like
probably
somewhere in the vault.
Somewhere, yeah.
That he thought they did. At one point, Anne falls and she's framed in Venom's eye. Very similar to the shot of Spider-Man's loved ones falling in his eyes. Mary Jane in the first Raimi film and Gwen Stacy in The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Shriek gets back at Carnage by blasting the bell, detaching everybody's symbiotes, and collapsing the tower, as well as the bell on Shriek. And Venom's able to gobble up Carnage, actually just as he does at one point in the comics. And he bites off Cletus' head, dropping this unfortunately rated PG-13 movie's one F-bomb. Now, in the aftermath, Eddie talks about Cervantes' Don Quixote, quoting, "Facts are the enemy of truth," lamenting that despite he and Venom aspiring to be lethal protectors and factually serving the public good by disposing of Carnage, the truth that society will only be able to see are them as a monster. And that distinction between facts and truth gets further warped in the film's ending. After a great closing shot showing the two runaways on a Mexican beach finally giving Venom that sand in his toes and wind in his hair that he had always wanted, a post-credit scene where Venom offers to open Eddie's mind to the symbiote hive mind, a hint that we might actually meet the Clintar Society in Venom 3, but then these two are suddenly transported to another reality, that of the MCU, with Venom reacting to J. Jonah Jameson's report on Peter Parker, probably the aftermath of Doctor Strange's spell in Spider-Man No Way Home, with which Venom is rumored to appear in, and this makes Venom officially part of the MCU. Now, I did break down this scene and its implications to No Way Home and the whole MCU multiverse going forward, all in another video, but I love that this film ends in this place of facts versus truth, because Eddie Brock and Peter Parker now have this in common, as two misunderstood vigilantes battling that false truth of the world seen
right.
as psychopaths. I think it gives them a common cause to fight as fellow lethal protectors in a world where reality
that
cannot
I
be
want
believed.
To see.
However, we must remember that Cervantes' Don Quixote ends with them burning the books because Quixote's fantasies are destructive, inferior to the real world. Ultimately, I think that's where Peter Parker will end up, choosing to live with his uncomfortable reality and reject the allure of an impossible dream. You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at EAVoss. Follow and subscribe to New Rockstars for breakdowns of everything you love.
All of this is crazy informative and like for me, you know, verging on mind-blowing, because I'm like, oh my god, there's like all these layers in there that I had no idea I would have not known existed if not for this breakdown video.
Yeah,
which is phenomenal and super super detailed. Like, it deserves details you missed, because there's a fuck ton of details that I missed in Venom, because it's just moving at a clip. I wish that, and I know I can probably watch these videos at a slower pace, like at 0.75 speed or something
yeah.
like that. It's moving so fast. At the end of it, I almost feel like I was just on Instagram for an hour. I'm like, okay, how much of that did I retain? Because that's the important thing, is like you're watching all this cool stuff and you're sort of taking what you can with you into the next thing. And I'm like, okay, how much of that can I hold on to? I want to hold on to more of this information.
Yeah.
And it's just because it's moving so fast. I'm like, oh, okay. So there's Prometheus, and then there's like the stuff from the comics, and there's the deviation from the comics, and there's the thing that was sort of like the video game, the Carnage video game or something like that. So there's like fraction of information that I'm sort of carrying with me. You know what I mean?
It's so interesting to me, like how many references they made to classic literature. Mm-hmm. Like you had Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, you had Lord Byron, you have Shakespeare in there. It's cool having them break down all of this stuff, because a lot of that, like I've read most of that stuff, except for the Byron poem. But like, I don't remember all that stuff off the top of my head. Like I knew that Something Wicked This Way Comes was mm-hmm. Shakespeare, but I didn't remember that it was from Macbeth, you know?
Yeah.
And so it's just kind of fun to see all of that infused and in how you might take those quotes, that stuff and
inspirations.
Just apply it to some deeper meaning that they're trying to put across in the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I appreciate all that. And it's too bad that like it all moves so fast in the film that you just miss it. Whatever Cletus was saying as he was, you know, being injected, I caught none of that. All of it just like flew over my head. It was going so fast.
It was going pretty fast, yeah.
And I honestly, if I'm being completely transparent, didn't care. It was just like, I just wanted to get back to Eddie and Venom.
Yeah.
Because every time they showed me Cletus or anyone else in the film, I'm just like, ah, it's okay. Well, this is like, I guess it's the story, you know? And then I just want to get back to hanging out with Eddie and Venom again.
Yeah.
Either one of them or them together.
I think they would be really fun with Spider-Man as well.
Yes.
Like, I'm excited to see how that pans out.
Well, I didn't know that they worked together. Like, I always thought Venom was just a nemesis of Spider-Man. I didn't realize that at one point they teamed up.
Yeah, I didn't know that either.
And so to see the comic panel that indicates that, I'm like, oh my God. The part that I appreciated the most of this video was actually that of getting the little revelations of, because I just didn't read the comics, like getting the revelation of like, this, there's actually material that supports their team up. Because I wasn't sure from the ending of Venom, like where that was going.
Yeah.
If Venom was just going to try to eat his brains or if they were going to work together somehow. And based on how New Rock Stars is breaking it down, I'm like, oh my God, like this is actually a perfect marriage because they're both misunderstood people at this point.
Yeah.
So that's great. Anyways, I really appreciated this. Thank you, New Rock Stars, for allowing us to react to this. Very, very much appreciated. I'll probably have to watch this again to fully absorb all those details that I missed and Easter eggs. So if you guys haven't already, please subscribe, hit that bell icon, all notifications, and vote this video up to let YouTube know you enjoyed what you watched. I'm Jabby Kawe. This is
Acharika.
Peace out.